But now that that's over, I want to welcome you all to Coffee Talk. Hope you guys all brought your beverage of choice, hot or cold, and we're going to have some really good talk. You know, I've been loving these Coffee Talks we've been doing for the last 3 months. They've been really nice. Some of my favorite, we talk to the legends in this industry, the pioneers in the industry. You know, we honor those ones that have come up and set the tone for all of us and what they've done and the struggles they've gone through and the path that they've cleared for the next generation of eyewear. And I love that advice that they give just so that their legacy can continue. Well, today we thought we'll flip it and we talk to the next generation of eyewear. We're going to talk to the next generation of vendors as well as retailers and really see the different cool ways and the different technology as well as ingenuity they're using to take eyewear to another level. So I'm really excited about this panel. We're going to get right into it. We're going to start on the East Coast and work our way to the West. And I remember this first panelist, the first time I heard of this panelist in the shop, I was looking at LYF magazine about a year and a half ago, and I saw this really cool optical. I mean, it was so, the way it was laid out, the furniture, the way they presented eyewear was so dope. And I was like, well, where is this shop at? Is it in Paris? Is it in Milan? Is it in Morocco? And I looked and it said, Boston, Massachusetts. So let's go to our first panelist. Christos, you there?
Yes, I am. How are you doing, Tarrence?
Good, brother. How about yourself?
Great. Thanks for having me.
Oh, man. It's an honor to have you on. So, Christos, while I know you, you know, many people know you. Why don't you go ahead and let people know who you are and a little bit about your business?
All right. I'm gonna kind of rocket through this as quickly as possible. Basically,
This is your time, brother.
I used to be a psychology major. I went to Richmond, the American International University in London. And when I got out of school, I had a hard time finding a place that I fit in. Nobody wanted to listen to a 21-year-old psychologist, you know? So what I wound up doing was I started a clothing company and I moved to Philadelphia and I ran that for like 10 years. It was called Company Policy Apparel. It was during the big streetwear boom and all of that. Somewhere in the middle of all of this, like, going back to the beginning, I always had like a weird obsession with sunglasses. Like when I was a kid, it was like Oakleys. I used to have Bollés. Like it went on and on. I stumbled into the shop in Philly called Eyesight. And mm-hmm. a great guy named yeah. Jim runs it. I'd seen like a newer James Bond movie, Quantum of Solace. The bad guy has some Cutler and Gross glasses on and he has wood paddle temples. And I was like obsessed with them. So I did a little search and found out that this guy around the corner from me carried them, and that was Gene in Eyesight. So Gene and I kind of started talking, and he kind of wakened me up to this whole like kind of obscure world of like actual independent designed eyewear. And kind of from there, I got hooked, and I kind of pivoted my company from being a clothing company into being an eyeglass company. I'd go on to spend 4 years figuring out how to make glasses out of wood. I made friends with a skateboard company in California and they kind of turned me onto this wood sunglasses idea. And I just like would keep bringing them into Gene and Gene would be like, well, this has to be like this or this has to be like that. And I got to the end and I made a good pair of glasses and then I was just like exhausted and didn't want to do it anymore. So I stepped away from that and decided that I really liked glasses. I just like didn't want to be in the factory all the time. So I became a licensed optician. I went to Dan Banks' program in Camden, New Jersey and learned the ins and outs of opticianry. And then I nailed the job with Lux Optique, which is a small independent optical in Beacon, New York. Kind of from there, I mean, from the beginning, I wanted to open up my own store. And, you know, this was always a concept. I remember telling people like, you know, 5 years before we opened, like, yeah, I want to do this thing. And you know, it's going to look like this. And I don't think anybody really got it. But yeah, after learning the ins and outs from Lux Optique, after getting my license, after making glasses, I was kind of like ready to do the store thing. And at that point, I'd already gotten married to my wife and she's like the absolute perfect like counterbalance to me. You know, I'm kind of good at the creative and talking part. And she's very good at the like, you know, paying taxes and bills part. You know, we got started. It was a lot of fun. We found the spot and it all just like came together. And, you know, my whole focus is just this like weird little niche of independent eyewear and like, you know, the good stuff, everything that has a story. And, you know, I try not to come at it from a pretentious angle. It's really just like, I'm into this thing. You're in my store and I'm playing show and tell with you. We're playing a lot of dress up and a lot of show and tell. So that is kind of the abridged version of who I am and where I came from and what the concept of the store is.
Absolutely. But Christos, when I first saw your store, I knew it had to be new because I was like, I know every store in Boston. I there's no way I could have missed this one. But your store really stands out. It really stands out. I mean, it's the aesthetics of it, the customer service. So, you know, shout out for you guys for doing it right.
Well, thank you very much. I mean, I feel like it's an honor to just be carrying the stuff that I'm carrying and doing what I'm doing. You know, and I got extremely lucky with the building. Like we were going to get one place and then they bailed on us at the last minute. And then I was actually on my honeymoon and this place popped up on Craigslist and we came home early to check it out and just put in an offer on the spot. So a lot of it's just the place, honestly.
No, it's people that run it. And shout out to your wife, Alyssa, who allowed you to come home from your honeymoon early.
Yeah.
So I have a question. There's a question here already, Christos, and I think you're probably the best one to answer this. It says, how long, this is from Morgan. Hey, Morgan, how long does it take to become certified as an optician? And are there any specific schools that are most well known for the opticianry program?
So, I mean, this ranges depending on where you are, you know, and it's a state by state thing. Some states, they just want you to be ABO certified. Other states, you do need to have your, you know, state license. So there are certain states that are a little bit more involved than others. I think Florida and New Jersey are kind of like the biggest ones. And for them, it was really like it's an associate's degree. So I went through, I had to do a couple of my general requirements over again, just because of weirdness with transferring credits and stuff. But you know, it's a full education. And this particular program that I was a part of, I really like can't say enough good things about. It's this guy, Dan Banks. He's over in Camden, New Jersey. So New Jersey is one of the harder places to kind of get licensed. And he's a young guy and he cares about it. And like, they're doing something cool. We had all of the machinery. And like, you know, it was every day you're kind of learning a little bit about this or a little bit about that. You know, you're going over anatomy of the eye. You're going over all of these like contact lens things. And, you know, it's kind of humbling because you're like, in the beginning, you're like, oh, I'm going to like a community college in Camden. And then you kind of start realizing, oh, this guy that's talking to me wrote the book that we're reading. Like, so there was a huge level of knowledge. And like, you know, I'd gone from making glasses to learning about opticianry. So like, I kind of went in there thinking that there wasn't much to teach me, and I was so wrong. Like, because, you know, optic principles, if light enters this medium going at this direction, you know, what's the angle of deviation, all of that stuff. So that, you know, there's a lot of that. And then every day you're in the lab and you're cutting lenses and you're figuring out how they edge in. And like, honestly, that it all helps build a bigger picture about like what this thing that we're doing is and how everything fits together. And it also gives you a lot of appreciation about, you know, the frames, even having gone from making them and knowing how involved it is to make them to like really get into fit and finish and, you know, panoscopic tilt and, you know, how adjustable a good pair of glasses is and all of that. Like, it's a business. It's all in the subtleties. And I think it takes a full like education to really start to appreciate them.
Absolutely. Well, anyone that visits SOMA, you know, opticianry is definitely in the forefront of their business. So let's take a trip. Let's keep on going west. No pun intended. Let's go west, W-E-S-T, to Flint, Michigan. Now, I met this guy. I was at Vision Expo 2015 when I first started, and I was at a pop-up talk, and it was going really well. Then all of a sudden, they asked for questions, and this guy gets on the microphone, and literally, he just dropped the most amazing gems on the mic. And I said, I didn't know who that guy is, and we need to be friends. And I researched him and I researched his company and I got to love him and his brand and what they stand for. So Wes, are you with us?
Yeah. Thanks so much for having me.
No, man. Thanks so much for being here. You know, let everybody know who you are and a little bit about Article One.
So my name is Wes Stoody. I'm the co-founder of Article One. Our story is a bit like Christos. It's a bit of a winding path. And so I'll try and shorten it, but you know, a lot of people at the trade shows, especially early on, you know, when we first started showing at Vision Expo, the first year, you know, I was like 23, 24 years old. And a lot of people would always ask me, like, how did you get into this business? And assuming that maybe I had family that were in opticianry or optometry or something. And I would usually say naivete and stupidity mostly. Just because, you know, I kind of just naively, as a senior in college, I became very passionate about a nonprofit called Helen Keller International. And I wanted to raise money for it. And so I just naively was like, I'll sell glasses. And, you know, didn't know what I was getting myself into. This is a completely other brand from Article One, but didn't know what I was getting myself into. But, like, you know, worked with a designer, found a factory, launched this thing about 6 months after graduating from college. And it was one of those moments where you're like, build it and they will come, and nobody came. So I realized I had to get off my butt and, like, just go walk into optical shops. And we really tie our origin story now, who we are as Article One, to when I first started walking into these independent optical shops. I started learning from the opticians and the optometrists that we started working from, and because I had no knowledge. And I really credit them a lot with who we are today. You know, first store we ever worked with was Lab Rabbit Optics in Chicago. Coyote is a great guy. Second was
Coyote.
Yeah, shout out to Coyote. Second was Nate Ogura at Eyes on Fremont. He's been a huge mentor to us. Third was Dr. Two at MyOptic. I mean, those are like first three stores we ever worked with this other brand, have stayed with us, continue to be mentors. So did that first brand for a couple of years and realized then that we were on a path in terms of building a brand that we wanted to build something else. We figured out a little more about who we are just as people and as a brand. We've now, you know, we're building Article One to, we want the end customer as well as the opticians, as well as us, to feel the connection at every point in the supply chain. From us, the designers in Flint, Michigan, the owners, small family owned, you know, my sister is my co-founder, small family owned brand in Flint, Michigan, working with small family owned factories in Italy, working with independent optical shops, generally family owned optical shops around the country. And we want the end customer to feel that connection. Through the details of the eyewear, through the consciousness, the purposefulness of our design and of our branding. It's similar, like if you were to buy a nice pair of jeans, you'd feel special. It would feel more special if you knew the guy who, you know, maybe they're in Detroit making small batch denim or something like it. We want the connection to be there and the purposefulness. It's been a very long winding path, but over time we've kind of just learned more about ourselves, learned more about who we want, what we want to do with this brand. And honestly, it continues to evolve. I can say that, you know, whenever we look back a year ago, 2 years ago, we're incredibly embarrassed by, either the product or but we're just trying to get better with the product, with ourselves, with the way we run the company. But it's been extremely fun.
I'll tell you, Wes, I will wear a 2015 Article One frame any day. So nothing to be embarrassed about. Nothing to be embarrassed about, bro. Nothing. And thanks for being here, Wes. Wes, you actually have a lot on your plate right now. You got to get your first child due pretty soon.
Yes. Right?
Six more days. So it was up in the air whether Wes would be here or not. But we appreciate you being here, bro. So. Let's continue going on. So I know someone that supports you and your brand very heavily was, you know, if you think about Los Angeles Opticals, one that stands out, always stand out, a staple, has been optometrics. So when I found out that Dr. Miles Zakheim's daughter was going to be opening up a shop, I knew it had to be magic. So Kyly, how are you?
I'm good. How are you? I'm so happy to good. Be here.
Thank I'm so happy you're here. Before we start, Kyly, I have a question for you. I'm almost done with this thing. Am I supposed to be full now?
No, I am never full. Juice is not a meal for me. I don't know.
Got it. Got it. I'm getting like LA 101.
Yeah, well, you should recycle that cup though, if we're really going to keep it LA.
All right. Definitely will. Definitely will. You have my word on that. So Kyly, why don't you talk a little bit about who you are? Tell us a little bit about the business model, what Zach stands for.
Well, my background is actually in the startup and nonprofit world. This is my entry into the optical industry. As Tarrence mentioned, my dad is Dr. Miles Zakheim. He's been in practice for 40 years. He has three locations in Los Angeles called Optometrics. And Zach is a partnership between the two of us. So this is our business. And it's been amazing to work together, and it's still very new. We opened about a year and a half ago. It really started from an idea he had been toying with for almost over a decade. You know, he really wanted to find a way to pair comprehensive eye care and quality care with an affordable eyewear option. You know, optometrics is a very high-end practice. And as we all have noticed, there's a real desire for an affordable option. And he wanted to find a way to accommodate that for his patients. And when we started talking about it, you know, that idea really led to what Zach is today, which, you know, to make a long story pretty short, really tries to bridge the gap between eye health and eyewear. I think, you know, many of us can agree it can be a pretty disjointed process for a lot of patients and customers. You're getting your eye exam one place, your glasses somewhere else, your contacts online, amazing sunglasses from your local boutique. And we really wanted Zach to be a place where you could get the best of all of it. So from a patient perspective, there was a level of efficiency that was being taken care of with this backbone of eye health, eye care focus. You know, how can we create a place, a brand, a voice that really gets people excited about or even just a little bit more aware of their eye health? So this whole process doesn't feel like an obligation or a chore or an annoyance. And we have a brick and mortar space on Fairfax, and you know, we are doing eye exams, and we have our lab on site, and we sell amazing brands at the store like Article One. But we also, in order to really close the loop on this process, design our own line of eyewear. And this line is based off of 40 years of my dad's sales, which has been really influential in the line itself, because the concept is really about how can we provide essentially your everyday, your uniform, jeans and a white t-shirt, that thing that you can return to time and time again, that is your staple, at an affordable price. So our line, which is six shapes, you know, a couple styles and colors, super easy to navigate. The idea is to solve for what can be an overwhelming process. And those frames sit alongside some really unique brands so that, again, we can really give our customer that 360 experience.
Very nice, very nice. So Kyly, about a year ago, Zach was featured on Vogue.com. We're seeing that article. How did that feel? I mean, so a new store and featured with such a large platform.
Was awesome. we were so excited. I think, you know, a huge part of Zach and a huge part of, you know, I think everybody that's on the panel today, all of whom I admire very much, you know, our look and feel and our aesthetic is a huge part of our brand and our focus. And, you know, Wes just spoke to that as well. And I know that's a major focus for SOMA as well, that, you know, it felt really nice to be recognized by Vogue in terms of, you know, our look and feel and our approach, and really essentially give credibility to our concept to a fashion audience, which, you know, the more and more I dig into optical, you know, yes, I think by virtue of my dad, I have been somewhat in the industry my whole life, but really I haven't. You know, I didn't work a day in one of my dad's stores, and wow. I really am, you know, getting my education as we, you know, have been through the process of opening this business and then being open. I actually am an optician myself. I took the tests and all of that in preparation to open. And so, you know, it's been really interesting having the conversations about where Optical fits into the fashion world. And I know that there's a lot of push and pull there. And so it felt really nice to be recognized in Vogue for that reason, and also to give our health concept a platform. You know, obviously wellness is a huge part of everyone's day to day, especially now, you know, especially given everything happening with coronavirus. So even back then, it felt very nice to be recognized for those two things on that particular platform.
I agree. And speaking of keeping eyewear fashion, I think our next panelist really comes from the fashion industry, did an amazing job of blending and showing the importance of where eyewear fits into fashion. Ahlem, are you there?
Hi, everybody. I am.
What's going on?
I'm very happy to be here. I'm good. This is my second panel with you, but no offense to the others, but these people, man, I'm happy to be with.
They're cool, right?
Yeah, really, really cool. I feel honored to be with the three of you. I only knew West. We met once, and Christos is carrying Ahlem at SOMA, and I only heard a good thing. And you, Kyly, we share a good friend.
It's funny that, you know, you're here again. I was telling someone, he said, you know, Ahlem and I are really close. How do we get to know each other? Ahlem actually called me one day because I posted something on my social media that she didn't agree with. And we talked it out, and we've been brother and sister ever since. So it's great. It's great. You know, that's what it's all about, right?
Yeah, apparently I'm known for saying what I think.
That's why you and I are here.
Yes, we're really close. I'm Ahlem. I'm a founder of Ahlem Eyewear. I am French, I am a Parisian, but 6 years ago we moved here in Los Angeles. I live in Venice Beach. And in this city, we decided to create Ahlem. Before to move here, I had it's a lifetime passion. I have a thing for eyewear. See, like I always say, like people have things for, like, I don't know, cars or heels or bags or whatever. I don't collect any of this. I collect eyewear, and it's been something in me for a very long time. So yeah, indeed, I come from fashion industry. I was a buyer for Acne. I was a buyer for Prada Group, the clothing, not the eyewear, because it's Luxottica. It's been like such a great experience, because in the both companies, the Swedish company and the Italian company, not only I learn to do my job, but I also learn how to like have a 360 view on what you do. So when I decided and to go for the eyewear, that we were still living in Paris, and I literally Googled French factory of eyewear on Google, and I called a few of them. They're like, sorry, ma'am, not gonna happen. Only one accepted to see me. And I will explain to you why, for the people who may be listening and trying to do their brand, I will tell you why this factory is in France, or he didn't want to see me at first. So the one that accepted to see me, I went there and I hang out, and I came with like the idea of maybe doing few glasses, you know, and few prototype, and maybe I do a show. Maybe if I write order, I can go produce. And they're like, it's not that gonna happen. What's happening is you do a prototype, you place your order, and when you have your bulk, you go do your show. Because the risk, it's not a fashion risk. This is an eyewear risk. This is people who do everything by hand. It's such a complication process. So it's a real partnership. And that word partnership took me over the 6 years with everybody we work with. Partnership is a key word, at least for us. and I guess for the three of my co-panelers, I said that. And I know, yeah, so that, and I'm gonna tell you why the other people, other factory didn't wanna see me in France is because often at the time people go, they do a prototype and then they go to other countries to produce. And it's not good or bad, it's just using our the knowledge of the best craftsmanship in the world to do the base and then go to open to other countries, maybe fast or maybe cheaper. So those factories have been burned in the past, so that's why they didn't want to see me. Anyhow, I went, I hang there, I hang out with all of them. I stayed in Oyonna, which is south of Paris, 2 hours by train. And I hang out there. I just, before even creating a workshop partnership we have created, I can't say friend, but we become to know each other. What is the motivation? What they are doing? Why I'm coming from nowhere? I want to do glasses without having a parent in there. Without, you know, those. I don't come from an eyewear heritage, and so the credential haven't been there. Anyway, so that's 2013, and then November 2013, we moved here in Los Angeles. January, I received my first prototype. April 2014. We receive the stock, 1,000 piece of a 7 different frame, 5 color each. And then the show become real and I had to go sell this stuff. So here I am from a French, like, become designer in LA, a town I didn't know anybody, and just knock doors and well, it paid off. April, we received the stock. In May, we break even. In June, we were sold out. And I thought by then we had something in our hands. And again, it's because I have learned the 360 view from the brands I have been working. I have been mentored and I follow who became my friends today, the designer of acne and the worldwide buyer at Miu Miu Prada at that time. So it's really like taking this information from everywhere. Anyhow, we did our first show in Paris and then we start selling quantities and it became real. So, and then I meet wonderful people in this industry. I mean, it comes with the reps that I used to have and the reps I have today. The stores that literally gave me wing. It was a C by Karina store here in Los Angeles. She's not any longer having the store, but the first time I saw her, she's like, she goes, I never see something like this. And today, just like you, Wes, like maybe like 6 years ago, the collection wasn't that good, right? It's we evolving, but having this woman who's selling Dita, Cromart, all this amazing brand, Tom Brown, and telling me out of nowhere, I never see something like this, that gave me the wing that we are today. So that is Ahlem. And what is we really stand for and about. So our product is, as I said, is handmade in France. This was very important for me because in France we have the best craftsmanship in the world for eyewear. It's a heritage knowledge. It goes like 100 years back. They know what they are doing, and so them and me, my design creed is what we have today. We work with 22 karat gold for the metal. We work with a Mazzucchelli acetate, which has to be the best acetate in the world. It's made in Italy for the acetate, made in Italy. And the design is, you know, it's something like, it's that no-brainer. And I joined you, Kyly, there. It's that like, it's the way I would consume, and I'm sorry to talk about me, but as a designer, so it's the way I would consume, right? I will not buy 100 shirts. I would buy that shirt that I know I'm gonna keep in my closet forever. I don't consume. I never had consumed fast fashion either today for my son. I really try to have this, not just a sustainable word because it become a kind of trendy word, but more like, how do I consume? How I want my eyewear to be consumed and how I want me wear what I'm doing. I wanna be proud of what I'm doing. I wanna wear what I'm doing. And I want my husband, my family, my friend, whatever it is, to wear what I'm doing and not have to, it's kind of a control freak, but I don't want to hear, oh, your glasses break, oh, you know, the kid, you know, like, you know, it's okay, she's good, she does very well, it breaks, that's okay. I can't do this. I will not sleep overnight if I heard any problem with a defect or anything like it can happen in a factory with it. So human factors. So that type of consummation, that type of, I consume books, so I travel, or I wear dress, like I wear clothes or eat or whatever, is the way we do the glasses. I can imagine the guy or the girl who, like, you know, she today she's on the beach and tomorrow she's traveling for doing her job in a further country, and her glasses will be the same because that glasses, they can take her or take him in every place in the world because it's, the quality there is, it's a, is that statement that sorry, not a statement, but it's that solid piece that will, I don't know, that give you the confidence without eating your face or without being in your face, right? No showing off. Understated, that's the word, understated. So this is Ahlem, this is what we're doing. And one thing, we just briefly talk about the current state of sustainability, and everybody's talking about sustainability, and you know, this big word who's become a word. The way we produce is the way we consume. It's unsaid sustainable. Like our factory work with the solar panel, the people are paid correctly, the hours are respected, the lunch hour is 1 hour, the human factor, this is what's sustainable. It's not just like, you know, I made my glasses with a plastic bottle from the beach, amazing. That doesn't tell you you're sustainable. That's you're green, you're trying to clean the world, but you're not sustainable because you're doing plastic bottle glasses. It's, and I think this is very important that we put words where the words are belong. And sustainability is respect the people, what they're doing, respect the factories, respect the shipping, how you ship, how you consume, how you produce, how many glasses do you produce a year? And it's very important to know this, as today as a consumer, we went through COVID. I was one of the ones saying, please wear this change. Maybe he won't, you know, we humans, we have short memory, but maybe if we keep one thing is to keep on consuming only what we need and the way that we need it to be produced. So the way that we need us to be working for, if I was working for a factory, I want to be treated the way that my craftsmen in our factories are treated. So this is what's sustainable for me.
I think, Ahlem, no one can deny that you as a person and your brand are both full of integrity. So, sister, we appreciate everything you do. So, let's keep it on the West Coast. Let's keep it on the West Coast and head down to some of these retailers. So, Kyly, the last 3 months have been unprecedented. And now we can see that many of our cities are reopening, and I know you've reopened. So, what's the new normal now, post-COVID, for Zakheim's?
Yeah. Because we're a medical practice, you know, well, first I'll start with, you know, every state, city is going to be a little bit different when it comes to what has been available to them at this time. And for us in Los Angeles, we were able to open a little bit sooner than a retailer because of our medical practice. And so early May, or around mid-May, we were able to open a few days a week, appointment only to see our doctor. And you know, that involved a lot of prep, sort of the new normal of coming into the store from a sanitation perspective, disinfection, capacity, not just ensuring the safety of our patients and customers, but our team. I'm sure we're all going through this right now, making sure everybody feels comfortable and safe at work is sort of priority number one. If we don't feel safe, we can't possibly provide a safe environment for anybody coming into our space. So the new normal has really been a lot of prep in order to open properly, ensure we have the right amount of PPE, hand sanitizer, you know, aesthetics, as I just spoke about, are incredibly important to us, but we've really had to change a few things. You know, we don't have fresh flowers in this space, or we don't have our art books out. We're really minimizing surfaces that you can touch. Tarrence, you know, I know you love our fresh made carrot juice. At Zach, we pre-COVID made fresh made carrot juice every day for all of our patients and customers. You know, we have halted production on that. So, you know, some of the uniqueness of what we offer, you know, we've had to minimize for the time being, but of course it's our product and services that are the mainstay of what we do. And it's just figuring out a way to provide those things safely. You know, we used to be open 7 days a week. So fewer days a week has definitely been a huge change. We're cramming a lot into fewer days. And, you know, patient care is not you're in the store for an hour and then that's it. You know, we need to be available to you even if we're not actually physically open. And I think lucky for us, since we opened, we've had a fully functioning website. So our e-commerce has been a very important part of our brand. You know, you're able to upload your prescription to our site and order a pair of glasses with anything from a tint to blue AR to transition. And all of that has been very easy to do, but we haven't focused on it as much as we would have liked to because, you know, we're a small team and we have a brick and mortar operation to run and a doctor's office to run. And this time has really allowed us to shift to that. So we sell our contact lenses online, we sell our curated brands online, we sell our Zach frames online, and it's really allowed us to focus our attention there to, you know, make up for the days that our store is not actually open. LA has lifted restrictions for retail as of last week, so we will be opening. We will be opening for more days next week. It's just a matter of, we want to make sure we're doing it correctly. We want to make sure that we're providing the right environment, both for our brand and services and for what our customer wants. I think a huge thing is to factor in what's happening on your block. Are the stores on your block open? What are the restaurants doing? That's really going to indicate, I think, the pace that you should take. And that's what we're doing. You know, obviously, I'm very lucky that I have my dad to work with on all of this. And he has three other locations in three other neighborhoods in Los Angeles. Those neighborhoods are operating differently than, you know, my neighborhood. So it's really sort of taking the pulse of your customer, your neighborhood, and what you can do and provide safely. That's really been our pivot. And I feel grateful that we have such a robust website that we can really focus our energy on.
Absolutely. But Kyly, I hope that you still, if I'm ever in Fairfax, I can still get a one-off carrot juice made for me.
Hopefully our juice production facility will open soon. Give us a couple weeks.
All right. I can't wait. So let's head to Christos. Christos, what about you? What's the new normal now in Boston? And what's happening with SOMA Optical?
Well, I mean, new normal's kind of obviously changing from a day-to-day thing. Kind of what happened in the beginning of this thing was that, like, I just really didn't want to lose any momentum. And the online store was something that I'd wanted to do, but like never had energy for. So that's kind of where we went in the very beginning of this was I went gung ho. We bought, you know, camera equipment. We're taking all of our own pictures. We're doing everything by scratch. And it is super intensive and time consuming. So we did a bunch of that. The other thing that's been going on is, like, so we use Google Voice for all of our communications for the phone system and everything. So basically what happens is anytime a phone call comes to SOMA, my cell phone rings. So I've been kind of servicing people like that. Alyssa and I have been running all over Boston, delivering people their glasses. People have set up appointments and driven by the front of my store, and I've basically adjusted their glasses from their car. We've been taking the occasional appointment here and there. Like, you know, if you want to get in touch with me, I'm a healthcare provider. I think it's super important that I'm reachable. But at the same time, like, you know, we were one of the first ones to close on our neighborhood because it didn't feel right being open right at the end of the beginning there. I wanted to, feel the temperature, just like what Kyly was saying, like it's all about your neighborhood. It's about what's going on. It's about making other people feel comfortable. And so now we're kind of getting into this place where we're thinking about what the new normal is really going to be. And the thing that I keep hitting my head against, my philosophies about my store in the first place are minimalism, a lot of empty surfaces. I want to direct attention to the details of the frame anyway. So like we got very lucky as far as the way that we do all of our inventory and everything, that it is very kind of open and clean. I got like a UVC like washer type thing to sterilize everything after it's tried on. We have like UVC wands and we're wearing masks and we're maintaining distance. But it really is, it's tailoring this experience around people's comfort. And the way that I was kind of explaining it is it's like learning this dance, like sales in your store is kind of like this dance. We've been open for a year and I feel like we were finally just kind of nailing it. Where you're just like, it's not about you, it's not about anything, it's about you helping these people. And there's a certain, value to how graceful the entire experience is. You know, like how much space are you giving this person? Like, are you listening to them? Like, how does this person want you to take the charge or do they want the charge? And like, it's a dance. So now we've added more steps to the dance. So now it's like, when am I going to disinfect this frame and put this frame back, right? Because we pull everything apart. We try everything that the person wants on the person. And typically I'm cleaning and putting away while we're trying on new things. That keeps me from having a massive pile of glasses at the end of every sale. But it also kind of stops me from having to throttle how many glasses people are trying on. Because like I'm really going from the fashion perspective. And I can't have a fashion store and be like, okay, you can only try on five, or like, you need to look at these ones that I'm showing you. Like, so it's all about workflow and it's all about doing this in a comfortable way. And you don't want to like weird people out, like, and you don't want a big pile at the end of all of it. And, people want to know that you're going safe. Like there are certain things that I think are necessary now, like hand sanitizer front and center. And they need to see you sanitize your hands every time you do something that involves touching anything that they're gonna touch or touching anything at all. But you don't wanna talk about it because there's this level of now you're taking it too far and now it's just like, you don't know how they feel about this whole thing. You don't know if you're now making this into a bigger deal in their head or adding to this thing. So like for me, it's really just how do I gracefully just take all of this stuff that's going on, use this to make my business better, make everything as sanitary, make everybody as comfortable as possible, but also just making it feel more natural. And so that's the whole thing. It's a dance and it's learning this new step in it.
I love it. I love it. Let's go on to Wes. So Wes, I was so excited when I saw your big announcement for Article 1 that you guys were opening up your first flagship store. Right there in Michigan, your hometown, where Article 1 was birthed. So you launched the store and, everyone's excited about it. And then all of a sudden, we're hit with COVID. How was the flagship store affected and what's the future now for Article 1 flagship?
So we launched, I think in early February or mid-February was kind of our launch party, opening our flagship store. And our flagship is really a showroom for the brand, for Article 1. We are super excited about it. Worked with some friends, some carpenters to really create a beautiful shop. And the kind of motivation around creating that the flagship was really to just be more a part of our community. For the last few years, we've just been like on the fourth floor of, like an office building in terms of our main office. But last year, about a year ago, we were lucky enough to rent out a very large retail space that we've basically divided up, where part of it is the flagship and then the back part is our offices. And so previously, when we were on like the fourth floor of this office building, we would have like every day, every other day, someone would come up on the elevator, come to our office to shop for glasses, like just someone in the community. And it wasn't the most conducive environment to, you know, retailing Article One frames. So yeah, that was the big inspiration behind creating the flagship. And then, yeah, you know, a month later, we shut everything down. And it's still shut down because it is a part of our office. We just have right now one person going into the office each day to ship out orders. So we're shipping orders a little slower than we typically would. But it's just when we first shut down, I literally grabbed you know, like five pieces of each of all of our SKUs or most of our SKUs, and took a car full of frames down to my house, including like all shipping materials and stuff. And for the most of the duration of the shutdown, I was shipping all patient orders and stuff because some of our customers remained open for quite a while. And and I didn't really feel comfortable asking anyone on the team to go into the office. So yeah, I was just shipping out patient orders and stuff from my house for like 6 weeks there. Now we do have like one person on the team, a couple people alternating days, going in, and it'll stay that way for a while. Our customer service team is able to work from home. Maggie and I both work from home. And we're not really in a rush to, get everyone back in the office. I think it's at this point, it's safest or it's just smartest for us to take it day by day, see what's going on with the pandemic in general, but then also there's no sense to pressure anyone to go into the office. And so the store, which was never meant to be a big part of our revenue or anything, will remain closed until we think it's smart to just open the whole office back up. So.
Absolutely. Do you foresee when you do open up the store, things will be laid out differently or be changing around things for when customers do enter?
Yeah, that's something that we honestly haven't even spent time on just because it's not a priority in terms of opening the store back up. We're just so much more, how we've approached the pandemic more from like, how are we as partners to our factories in Italy and to the retailers that we work with around the country. That's been our focus the whole time. I mean, that's why I was really trying to get stuff shipped out during the shutdown. And now it's like, it's a lot of conversations with, our sales team, to see how they think the best way. I really rely a lot on our reps to tell me what they think is the best way to move forward. And then we try and obviously create a cohesive plan. But you know, they know their accounts a lot better than I do. They know what's going on in their region a lot better than I do. And we're trying to just create space, honestly, for people. One, because people are opening up at different paces, even in the same city. Two, they could be in completely different financial situations, and I don't want to put pressure on anybody. I think it's best if we just focus on checking in with people and seeing how we can move forward together best.
Absolutely. I think the ones that are doing that, vendor and retailer, those are going to be the ones that partnership is so important right now, especially. So, you know, shout out to you guys, Wes, for, you know, being amazing partners to your retailers. They're going to remember you now, you know, when all this is over. So, now, Ahlem, you are the kind of the same boat, Wes. I was so excited to hear that you were launching the New York flagship in Soho, and that was February, and you know, I came down and saw this amazing space that you have there, and then we got COVID. So what's the store right now for the Ahlem flagship in New York?
So yeah, so and then we get COVID. That's exactly the story of my life right now. There is LA and there is a New York. For the LA store, we closed pretty early compared to our community here in Venice. We are a medical device. We're too near for our clients, so we had to close. The day where my team put the gloves on to touch the glasses, the day we have decided that it's time to close. So we closed pretty early. So we we have that. But then New York as well, obviously. So New York, we had this beautiful store. We just won a design award for it as a best retail store.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It's kind of a nice surprise during this COVID situation. But yeah, we closed literally 2 weeks after we opened. It is what it is. I mean, the store is there. We have a 5-year lease. We have a beautiful building, nice landlord. It's on Elizabeth Street. Literally, my dream came true. When in 2017, when I won the CFDA award, that was like my only dream. I literally won the CFDA award thinking I'm going to get the store right away, but I didn't. But it was the street I wanted to have, and we accomplished it. So yeah, of course, there is a bump in the road. It's bigger than we thought. It's COVID. But we will open. In fact, we are reopening here, just as you, Kyly, in Venice. We had crazy protocol, right? It's one person working. It's by appointment. Each client have 1 hour. We think this is enough to... we're not doing... we take prescription, but we're not doctors. We're here opticians. Client come in, but spend 1 hour. The appointment is online. You go on our website, you take an appointment. And then after the client leave, we leave half an hour time to sanitize the entire place. We're learning more about COVID. I mean, there is searches that are real, like mask is an obligation. The surfaces is unlikely to get COVID from, but we still, it's the perception is real. We need to sanitize. And as Christos, you are saying, it's not just COVID situation sanitize. It's a perception. It's what you or your team or the client feel. Is it a safe environment? Are they understanding what's happening in the world right now? It's more about this. So we do it by appointment, but it has been. So we started appointment last Friday. And it has been such a great experience, right?
Nice.
And it's so nice. Listen, like who never dreamed to come inside a store? We lock the door after you, and you have everybody. And if I mean, you have only one optician, but you have that optician and the entire collection just for you. I mean, it's a dream. It's a kid dream, right? It's like you can play around, you can do whatever you want because this is your store for that hour. We're pushing further this experience. I'm looking for single serving coffee, single serving like beverage
green juice is happening.
Yeah, and also I'm not a big fan of green juice. Let's talk about it.
It's all right.
There's so many things about the green juice that I don't 100% agree, but yeah, I mean, I'm still Parisian, right?
That's right.
It didn't hit me yet, but the carrot, it's something special. The first of all, it's orange, it's not green.
There you go.
I take the carrot over the green anytime. But yeah, we're trying to develop a new retail experience. For us, service is important. Clientele and relationship with the people coming in the store is extremely important. It's everything. When people step in, it's coming to your house. So you have to be a good host. So this is what we're trying to do here. We give masks to our clients. If they don't have a mask, we give them gloves, we sanitize, we have a distance. And I have bought, because John Bean, our magic optician in the wholesale, exclusive wholesale in West Coast had made some searches, and we found these two cool mirrors that you put a mirror on the table and the mirror will to the client, the client wear the glasses and then we know his PD and the distance and everything that the optician needs. And this is great because we don't have to put that machine. I'm not optician, Kyly, sorry. So, you know, the technical words, not my thing yet, but it's going to come. Actually, I was inspired by you. Maybe I should try to do the optician thing.
I'm still very much learning. I feel like my team of opticians, I'm always like, you know.
Yeah, here we go.
You know. Yeah.
But So somebody just asked, it's a mirror to read the PD. Yes, it's a mirror to read the PD. It's super cool. It's nice. It's the most designed one. There's many of them. And so you have the mirror, and the mirror is intelligent mirror. Up, it goes straight to your face. It tells you the distance, and it goes to a tablet, and voila. And I think this is will be, it's amazing, A, for now, but for the future. I mean, you sometimes we're not very so precise. Maybe we don't know something, or it's, this gives you a precise, it's faster, it's cleaner, it's safer for everybody. So this is what we have done. And again, yeah, it's, where do you get it? Somebody asked. Well, Google help you. Google would be a very good help. I can send you John, but he might be overwhelmed. So I guess Google would be amazing. So this is what we have done. And on the street, we pay attention to the street. We pay attention to what people are doing. It was protesters in LA. So people in our street, everything is boards on. We put boards. We take care of the day after, because I didn't feel it right. For many questions, and maybe it's not the subject right now, maybe later in this conversation, but I didn't feel right to hide. And I didn't feel right to not welcome the marcher. So I had to take off the board. So I was the only one. It was fun. I felt like the beginning of Abbot Kinney, maybe 40 years ago when I wasn't here. But yeah, it's a safety. It's a safety of the clients, safety of my team. But it's working. Jenny here is extremely happy to have these people come in when they take an appointment. In general, they get something. They're happy about the experience, and we have frames for literally every face. So they most likely will find something. They are Ahlem connoisseurs, that people that know our brand. You know, they don't come from nowhere because they don't come from the street. I mean, it's not just fit traffic. So those people know us already. So it's kind of it's in the community of the brand.
I think Ahlem, just to piggyback off of that, we're by appointment only, not just for doctor's visits, but also for frame selection. And I think this is a really important point. We're noticing similarly a really, really, really high rate of conversion, because you have people coming in who really want to be there. You know, what you're cutting out, exactly. Which obviously is beneficial for its own reasons. You know, people may be ambling in because they want to kill 5 minutes before they go to their dinner reservation. Or they're looky-loos, exactly. Or, you know, all of those things are, you know, you can create lifelong relationships from those people ambling in. And we love that.
True,
we
want of course.
Get back to that community. Yeah. But don't be fearful of an appointment-only structure, because we're finding it to be really amazing to have that structure right now for our own safety, but also from a customer experience, as Ahlem is saying, you're in the store for this period of time and you get to have this new experience that you wouldn't have had otherwise.
Absolutely, and we will keep it. I had Alice, you met Kyly, who's come up with an amazing idea. She's like, we have slow days. Everybody, in 1 week, you have one day, it's slow, you know that day, or the half day. You know that Tuesday morning is not the best, right? That Tuesday morning, we close for looky-loos or people coming in the street for only appointment. And we will keep this forever. Because I do think there is people who don't want to hang with the crowd. There is people who they just have that time and they just want to do their thing and they want to go after. And that's why the personal shopper has been a big thing in the fashion industry, or going to all-time bounties, and you have this salon, and then they take care of you because it makes you feel special, and it makes you feel, you know. And I think this is, we will keep. I like it. I really love it. My team loving it. The relationship is great. That we not close ourselves from people coming from the street who didn't know us, which is 80% of our business in Abbot Kinney. So we're not gonna, you know, we'll be happy to go back to normal business. But it's just a conversation. It's a day by day. Sometimes people, the door is open and we have this call that doesn't let you come in. But we talk, you know, like, hey, you know, let me take an appointment for you. And we convert people out of the street. And it does work. So day by day, in a very gentle way and easy, and not too intellectualize all of this. It's just be clear, but easy.
I think strategies post-COVID, what I'm seeing happening is a lot of the experienced business owners in our industry who we learn a lot from are looking to this next generation of business owners because of how innovative all you are and progressive you guys have been, and looking to see what you are doing, getting suggestions. I think this is a great platform to have the four of you on. Let's move on now. Kyly, I want to speak with you. I think it would be we'd be remiss and insensitive to not bring up what's happening right now in the world when it comes to the issues and inequalities that are facing the Black community. Now, I know at Zakheim-Rabin, Kyly, you guys have been putting out statements, very strong statements. You have been bringing resources to people's attention, having become allies of the Black community. So just in general, how is that going and why did you guys decide to do that?
Yeah, this is just such an extraordinarily important time and long overdue. And I think as brands and businesses, let alone as people, we have a responsibility to be a part of this conversation. And for us, it was just non-negotiable. And I think as a brand or a business, you have a responsibility in the same way that you are utilizing technology and varying platforms to, you know, promote any kind of business message. I think at this point, there is no choice. This is not a small conversation. This is an inflection point. This is really a revolution, and you need to be vocal about what side of the conversation that you are on, because it is so much bigger than our businesses. And I think we're very lucky to have the technology and to have these platforms to utilize our voices in a way that was impossible even 10 years ago. You know, I think technology is allowing us to see footage in a way that is maybe shocking for some, although it shouldn't be because this has been going on for so long. But I really think that we are here because so many more people are able to see the injustice because of technology, that we have no choice but millennial businesses to share our voices, share our opinions, and make a difference in that way, and educate ourselves and learn. And, you know, and I think it's very tied into what consumers want. You know, this is not, you sell a product, someone buys a product. I think all of us on this panel are so much more than that and have been so much more than that since inception. For us, it's non-negotiable. And if anything, you know, it's not going to be something that runs parallel to our work. It will be a part of our work. It will be a foundation of what we do and be woven into our business. It's something that is that crucial.
Now, I saw the videos of Optometrics about a week ago, and it got looted pretty badly. And I, you know, my heart goes out to you and your father with that. 2 days later, you posted a very strong statement in for Zakheim-Rabin. You were in support of Black Lives Matter. You were in support of the protests. Were you at all concerned about why I might lose business now? I might lose, how it's gonna reflect on customers that shop here?
To be honest, I didn't even think about that. That was not a concern of mine when, or ours, because, you know, what I want to be very clear about is, you know, the statement from Zach is also very much a statement from my dad, and which, you know, is sort of another nuanced point of, you know, having conversations with our parents and other generations, maybe for some, can be a little bit complicated when it comes to this subject. I'm so proud that for me, that was not the case. My dad and I have been on the same page from 7 a.m. when I met him at Optometrics on Sunday morning after the looting. So that statement is very much from him as well. And no, we weren't concerned about that. I think it's so important, especially if you are a business that was looted, to, you know, you can be even more effective by sharing your perspective because it happened to you. of saying, this is a byproduct, this is a sideshow, we need to focus on the main issue. Was that video very painful for me to watch? Of course, you know, it always will be. It's very personal, and it's a very unfortunate thing that happened, but there is something so much larger going on here, and it's really important that we unite our voices and our focus. And there's no, you know, it's a complex issue, and I do believe there, in this particular instance, there isn't a wrong way to protest. And I think there's a lot of rogue commentary. The looters aren't protesters, and you know, I don't think that really should be the conversation we're having right now. It doesn't really matter. There's a larger conversation that really, really matters. So from a revenue perspective, you know, maybe it is something that I should have thought about, but I not for one second thought about it. And I think if anything, when it comes to thinking about revenue, let's think about our Gen Z consumers, these are the consumers who are aligning themselves with brands whose values that they share. They are not buying products just based on, you know, something that their friends like. They want to make sure that the brands that they're bringing into their lives are representative of their values. And I think if anything, those are the kinds of consumers that we want.
Well, that's well said. I'd love to get everyone's opinion on this, but we're running out of time. But I know all four of our panelists have taken a very strong stand. If you get an opportunity, go to their social media pages, read their statements. But millennials, I love about millennial business owners, they're not afraid to take a strong stand. They're not afraid to leave with integrity with their heart. So this is our last question. We're actually 10 minutes over, so I'm going to ask you all to limit this last answer to 1 minute. And the question is very simple, but it can be very complex. And that's, what's next? What's next for your brand? What's next for Iowa? Let's start in Michigan. Wes, what's next for Article 1? What's next for you? You're having a baby.
take a couple weeks off. You know, I think over the years we've been zigzagging, and it was because we didn't know who we were as a brand. And so now that we've really truly have done the work and figuring out who we are, we're just putting our head down and building our brand. We're focusing a lot on our active collection. That we've been having a lot of fun with. And then in terms of the industry, I would say, you know, I speak to a lot, is there's a reason why the companies like JCPenney, Macy's, and everything are going out of business when they're competing with Amazons and Walmarts of the world. I believe that the connections that you make with your customers, like Ahlem and Kyly spoke to, is the future of our industry. The more connected that the customer feels to you and to the product and to the people who made the product and the consciousness of that decision, is how people are going to thrive in this industry. I'd also be remiss to say that as a business, as a person, we have a lot of work to do on ourselves to really truly be anti-racist within our company, our organization, and within the industry. So plenty of work to do there as well for a long time.
Well, just let you everyone know, about a week ago, Article 1 donated a full day of sales to numerous charities supporting anti-racism movement. So shout out to you guys. Whole week. Thank you, Wes. Ahlem, my sister, let's a quick response on what's next for Ahlem.
Oof.
I know it's hard. What's
next? No, you know, it's keep it that way. Try to keep what we're doing, trying to keep our heads focused on the work we have been doing the last 6 years. Progressing in our design, progressing in our relationship, tight up our relationship with our partners, be there for our factories and craftsmanship. I mean, during COVID, we represent 30% of the business of our factories. We didn't cancel any piece. We kept on doing, and even more, adding production in order to allow them to see future because they allowed me to see my future. So it's keeping there. Now in terms of community and responsibility towards the minority, towards the community that have not the access that we have and the luck we have and the privilege we have, we will keep on doing what we have been doing since the beginning of Ahlem, as we will support kids, families in need, women in shelters, families in homelessness. This is what we have been doing since the beginning. It's the switch will maybe happen. The Black community in this country have enough. So, and I can't talk a lot about it because I don't have the knowledge. I'm only here for 6 years. I see that the I can't say it without emotion. So sorry, I'm not.
It's okay.
It hurt me what's happening in this country. It hurt me what's happening to the minority and the community without no financial that we have. So we will continue helping them as much as we can. Sorry.
Listen, a brand and a woman with integrity. I've always said it. Kyly, everyone wants to know what's the next chapter or what's the new for what is happening with Zakheim-Rabin.
Yeah, you know, I think that during this time, our ability to focus on our e-com has been so exciting. And I think that, you know, we're hoping to really put as much energy into that as possible. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're still really new and we're very excited to build up our patient base. And, you know, really become a destination for your eye health and really focusing on that as a theme for us and sort of like foundation of what we do and finding ways to really make eye care something that is considered and finding ways for people to really make it a part of their health routine is something I'm super interested in focusing on. And then, you know, just to speak to, you know, Ahlem's feelings and, you know, Ahlem, your emotions are exactly, you know, my feelings. And I'm actually, you know, it's hard not to react that way. And, you know, I think so hard. We can't not. And I am very interested in finding ways as an industry for us to come together. This is, you know, something that we can make change our numbers. And I think that it's not just the world. There are things that we can do within our own industry by really coming together and working together, which I would be extremely excited about. And I've sort of been marinating on and not, you know, not ready to put something together formally yet, but it is something that I'm thinking about.
Yeah, I think the key is education. The key is having people knowing where they're from, being proud of what they are, and having the other side understanding what is going on, like the tick of the ears, tick of the hands from the eye. And it's a tough time, but it's such an important time in the American history, in our world history. I mean, the manifestation and the protests are in every country. And I want to just say something, and I'm sorry if I cut you guys, but Kyly, you said something interesting about the platforms and social media. The Arabs' revolution get bigger and the dictators went away because of the platform. Because of Facebook, because of Instagram, because of Twitter, people have showing that enough is enough, and they have showing and sharing to others. And the less we can do is to show our indignation and I don't know if we say this word, but the that we are against it. Like just talk about it. Whatever. If you can't help or you can't do, you can't give money to charity. You can't help. You saying it putting a word out is already a big deal because it brings the problem to a bigger platform. It spread the word, and this is the word that had been spread.
Definitely, no, it's very important to not keep silent on these matters. Christos, I'm gonna end with you, brother.
All right.
What's next with SOMA Optical?
So, multi-tiered question. Basically, for the immediate future, we're staying by appointment. I have a few fun things in the future. You know, when we open back up, I want to like really be able to open back up and feel good about it. Like, I mean, obviously we're in this weird time and it's not going to be the way it was, but you know, I want to give a little bit more time to process it. Stay by appointment. Our social media presence has always been important to me. You know, we said what we feel about this whole movement, which is, you know, Black Lives Matter. We're in full support. I'm not going to post anything else on our social media for a while. There's a revolution going on in America right now, and I don't feel that it's appropriate for me to try to show my eyewear at this particular moment. So, and I don't mean that as any disrespect to anybody else. We all have to make livings. But for me, I think it's my role to just keep quiet, not silent, but quiet to not pollute anything else with eyewear right now. Now, moving on to the future of this industry, that's something that I'm extremely passionate about. And I think it's something that really needs to change. And I love this panel because we're all on the same page here. But everybody's relationship with eyewear has been really weird. Like, it's not like shoes or another accessory, but like really, like, it's all of the supports there. You know, there are these amazing people making these amazing things that you need to rely on every day. But everybody's relationship with eyewear is you're going to go to the doctor. They're going to tell you you need glasses. They're going to walk you into this room. They're going to point at this wall, and you're going to pick which rectangle like fits you best. You're going to wear that pair of glasses for a year. It's going to fall apart, and then you're going to do it all again. Maybe you made it 2 years. And for me, this is a major fashion accessory. It's the first thing people see when it's in the middle of your face. And I think that it's our duty to kind of educate people on this and push this industry forward into a more fashion-oriented industry. And I think we can also be medically appropriate and do that. I think Black Eyewear is the perfect example of somebody who can keep it, you know, from an optometric point of view, still very professional, but also add this added level of, you know, I don't even want to throw around the word luxury, just, you know, shopping experience. So that's one thing that I really want to do and I want to push forward. I want to stop seeing the old, you know, optical places. Like, I want to see them still exist, but I want to see this profession become more exciting. So that's where I want to put all of my energy right now. And also, I just want to say another thing. Jody Schuler, I don't know if you guys know him, but he was really great to me when I first opened. I'm like crying a little bit now. But basically, what Kyly and Tarrence were saying about each other, how they like disagreed on something online and then became really close through it. That was like my relationship with Jody. And Jody and I spoke weekly about, we spoke about this particular coffee talk and how he was looking forward to watching it and how, you know, proud and excited he was of me being on it and all of that. And I don't know if you guys know, but I found out after we talked yesterday that he passed away. His family has a GoFundMe right now. And if you can help, please, by all means. But yeah, no, we just lost a really good one and I wanted to bring up his name.
No, I appreciate you. Could you type the GoFundMe link into the chat box so that everyone knows and they have that as well? Yeah. And our heart goes out to Jody. I've been doing this for a very long time. I've never met him, but we've been friends from afar through social media for a number of years now. I love watching him work at his shop there. So our heart goes out to Jody and his family. We want to thank everybody and all of our panelists for being here. We do these coffee talks every single Wednesday at 12:15. We look at issues that are affecting our optical community, that are of immediate interest. We touched on it quite a bit, and next week we are going to have the conversation because it's not time to keep silent on this issue. So please tune in for the very timely discussion called Open Your Eyes, taking steps to be an ally of diversity and inclusion. It's gonna be moderated actually by Dr. Danielle Richardson, who's actually works with Kyly at Zach. She's an amazing optometrist. And she's gonna talk with people from all over the industry, see why allyship or diversity and inclusion is so important right now. We have Coco and Breezy from Coco and Breezy Eyewear, Dr. Cheryl Reynolds from the National Optometry Association. We have Sherrianne James, Chief Marketing Officer at Essilor, and Dr. Howard Purcell, who is the president of New England College of Optometry. So we're looking forward to that discussion as well. There's also a poll that'll be going up. So if you see a poll pop up, please take that poll. It's gonna show some feedback on our courses and what we can do to add even some more income for interest in. I wanna thank all of our panelists. It's just amazing to see where eyewear is going. I think the four of you give an amazing representation of millennials that are taking eyewear to another level. And we're all gonna be following you. So thanks everyone for being here. Thank you
to you. Thank you for what you're doing.
Thank you, appreciate it. Thank everyone for being here as well. Tiara, thank you. David, thank you. Jeff, thank you. Maggie, I see you. And if I didn't call your name, doesn't mean we don't love you. It's just we have a lot of you on here. So we're signing off. Enjoy the rest of your day, but thank you for coming over to Happy Hour. Appreciate it. Bye, guys.
Thank you.
And that was amazing. Christos, thank you so much for sharing that. Yeah, I think it's a really great way of sharing Jody's legacy. Really appreciate you taking the time to do that.
He was a rare one, and thank you for allowing me to speak on him. You know, it's rare that somebody has that much passion and is just that open with you from the get-go. I just don't even know what to say. Anyway, thank you so much. I'm
great.
Humbled by you involving me in anything that you're doing, and I'm always enthusiastically ready to go and do the next one with you.
You know, it's interesting. It's not that we come up with these ideas and say, let's find a panelist. We look at the panelists and inform the ideas. So it's like, you look at Kyly, you look at Christos, you look at Wes, look at Ahlem, and you're like, man, what can we do to create a panel that will be so informative around these people? So you guys make the panel doesn't really make you guys. We go there first and then sort of talk around what's happening. And it's so great to have four people that are just all on the same page and going in the same direction to have a discussion like this.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We're very like-minded, mostly because we think you're the man.
Exactly.
Oh, man, you're the only...
Wes, you should try to get some sleep before the baby comes.
Yeah.
I mean, I tell you, my friend, it's going to be 4 years.
Oh, man.
So
yeah,
collect that good sleep.
Yes, brother. Yes, man. I saw your wife pop in door. I said, oh no, she's having a baby. Let's go.
I know. Yeah, that. No, she's doing. She's a doctor. She's doing virtual visits out in the other room.
Oh, cool. How's that going with the virtual visits?
Good. I mean, she works at University of Michigan Hospital, and they've been super gracious in terms of like right when the pandemic started in the U.S. They like. Because she was pregnant, they let her, she does all virtual visits. And actually she enjoys it a lot because she actually, most people show up for their visits. So
there you go.
Yeah. It's so nice. I have my doctor visits on the Zoom, and of course it's a public thing. Listen, it's so good. You don't have to drive there. You don't have to wait 3 hours in the waiting room. It's all good. It's so nice.
Yeah,
I think it's in the future.
It's here to stay for sure.
Oh, I didn't see Gary Black was on here. Gary, what's going on, brother? You stuck in here. Good to see you, man. Speaking of another person who's doing it right.
He's great. Yeah. Gary is like, it's very hard to stand up when, you know, when you're a brand and also when you are a store, because when you're a store, you depend on those brands, right? Not that we don't depend on stores. Don't take me wrong. We depend on the store, but we have, I don't know, like we have 500 stores or some, if, you know, not that stores are replaceable, but brands are sometimes way less replaceable, especially the brand that makes business. And Gary Black Optical will always stand up for what's right. And it's very interesting, this guy. He's always there and he follow his guts. You like it or you don't, doesn't matter. You follow his guts and he really does it right. And I know this guy for 6 years now, and I really, really appreciate him. I appreciate who he is. I don't know if he's here still, but
thanks, Gary, man.
That's very kind. Too kind.
He's unmuted. Gary, I love your
window. Are you muted? Oh, you can talk. So nice.
I love your window, Gary.
Permission to speak. Thank you. Thank you.
Very nicely done. Can I show it?
Go show it. Yeah.
What is that? Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So nice. I mean, and your social media, man, you're killing it. Like everything. So good.
Thank you.
We gotta do more of these, kind of get-togethers to share ideas.
Yeah.
So it's nice. So, all right, guys. Thank you, guys. This was great. This was like so good. Thank you,
brother. Like, thank you for being here.
No, we should have the recording out probably by Friday. So I'll send you guys all a copy of the recording to look at. But this was really good. And we got some really big things coming up soon. Kyly, you and I should talk because we have some, Ahlem and I have some things going on to announce really soon. And it'd be great to get your opinion on this as well. So I'll reach out to you.
Yeah, I'm excited about this, man. It's like, thank you, Terrence, for giving me this opportunity to understand American history, understand what's going on, and understand it more. And really having you as a leader, when I can see things, it helps me, and give me the opportunity to participate on this world's march. It's nice. Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Thanks for being part of this. All right, guys, I'm going to head out. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
Christos, my heart goes out to you as well as Jody's family. Anything you need, give me a shout.
Thanks for having me, man.
And I'll share that GoFundMe as well on my social pages.
Perfect.
All right, guys. Wes, get some rest.
Yeah.
Get some rest. Definitely get some rest. See you guys.
Bye, guys.
Thank you so much.
Take care. Thank you. All right, bye.
Bye.
Bye.